Imagine for just a moment. Imagine that it's election day and that you have just arrived at your polling place to vote. Imagine that you are you, exactly as you are right now. The only difference is, you are hard of hearing.
Welcome, right this way, ma'am. Just go to the letters that are the last of your name.
Hi, I need a photo and signature ID, please.
Could you repeat that, please?
A photo and signature ID, please.
Here you go.
Thank you. Could you please verify your current address?
I'm sorry, can you please look at me directly when you're speaking?
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't realize you can't hear. Can you verify your current address, please? Where you live, right now.
It's okay, you don't have to shout.
No, it's okay. Please give me your current address.
2144 Oak Street.
Now, would you please sign right on the line, sign right next to your name, right on the line? Okay.
My name is Linda Larson, and today, for just a short while, we're going to try to experience the world through the perspective of a few people with disabilities. We're going to get a feel for what it's like for them as they endeavor to do something many of us do without much effort and frequently without thinking. And that's the simple task of voting. Let's now take a closer look at the specific needs of our voters who are deaf or are hard of hearing. And before we go any further, please notice that I said voters who are deaf or hard of hearing. This common sense, respectful approach aligns with the very important concept that everyone, regardless of their abilities or disabilities, should be defined as a person first. A person who happens to have red hair or a southern accent or is deaf. Let's consider the first scene you saw in this video. You may remember that when our poll worker realized that the voter was hard of hearing, she thought that if she simply shouted, the voter would be able to hear her better. We learned that this is not the case with most people who are deaf or hard of hearing. Here's Chris Wagner, Vice President of the National Association of the Deaf, as he talks about this issue and others.
Speaking of that, I want to help and advocate. The majority of hard of hearing people have issue with clarity. At the practice, the deaf practice, and we leave it down. And it's not clear to them. I think most important measure they could do have an eye contact.
Now I'd like to speak to you for a moment about some very important things to remember when you're assisting a voter with developmental disabilities. For example, a neurological disorder. Please be aware that just because a person appears to have difficulty with things like speaking or walking, we should never assume that they do not have the mental capacity to exercise their right to vote. We do everyone a tremendous disservice when we make that assumption. We spoke with Laurel Bradley, a voter with a neurological movement disorder called dystonia, who said it best.
Dystonia didn't affects like my brain, it affected my limbs, and I wish that more people would try and, you know, look beyond the way I'm walking or whatever, just know that there is a brain in there and then that it does work.
Now let's turn to voters who are blind or have low vision, and once again, let's try to experience the world from their perspective. Let's step into their shoes, go back into our precinct, and endeavor to vote.
Okay, we're approaching three steps.
Got it.
And here we are at a magic automatic sliding door. Right?
I got my ID right here.
Oh, all right. The ID, great. Ooh, another magic door.
Hey, remind me to call Mom tonight.
Oh, yeah, right. And who's going to remind me to remind you? Oh, we have construction here. A little bit to the right here. And then the left, my goodness, look at all the wood.
Careful with the construction there. Now, welcome, please just go right to the sign-in table.
Ah, we have a gentleman here who seems ready to help us.
Hi, I'm here to vote.
Oh, I need his photo and signature ID, please.
No, no, that's okay. You can talk directly to me.
Okay. Can you verify your current address?
Sure. Only I can hear just fine.
Oh.
4343 Lake Ridge Road.
Oh. Okay. Well, yeah. Sign right here. No, here.
If you could give me a signature guide, that would really be great.
All right, that signature thing. Hey, Frank!
Yeah?
I got a blind person here. Can you get me one of those signature contraptions, you know, for blind people? No worries, sir. We'll get it right over. We'll get the whole thing taken care of. Meanwhile, you want a chair? Let me get you a chair.
No, I don't need a chair, but thank you.
Well, I'll get you a chair anyway. It's easier to sign when you're sitting down.
Can you imagine what it would be like if that's what you experienced in your life every single day? How would this make you feel? What would you want instead? How would you want people to treat you? Common sense tells us that you wouldn't want to be shouted at. You wouldn't want to be treated like there was something wrong with you. And you wouldn't want to think that everyone was staring at you. So as a poll worker, what do you do? What do you need to know in order to best serve the needs of your voters who are blind or have low vision? We spoke with Barbara Grill, a voter with retinitis pigmentosa, resulting in low vision, who gave us some excellent ideas, starting with one that is helpful with all your voters, regardless of whether or not they have a disability.
Just ask, how may I assist you, or what can I do to help you? You don't have to be formal in the language, just as long as you get the point across. How may I assist you? And wait for the person to respond to that, because some people are going to say, they're very independent, blind people included, totally blind people, will say, I don't need any help, believe it or not. And they don't.
Now, let's consider the task of serving voters with hidden disabilities. This one can be particularly challenging since we cannot always immediately identify who needs help and who doesn't. So let's heighten our awareness about this issue. There are many, many disabilities that people could have that will not be obvious to you. Perhaps someone is in severe pain and cannot stand for any length of time. Perhaps a person has physical or mental health issues, chronic fatigue syndrome, environmental or chemical sensitivities, an anxiety disorder, a hearing loss, or any number of other challenges that you simply cannot readily identify. Listen to DJ Cavalli as he shares what his experience is like as a person with hidden pain.
When we're younger, we think we're indestructible. I was 22. When I was burned and injured, I discovered what amazing creation the human body is. The damages to the body are so severe. I have 1/3 leg muscles that for me to stand or even sit for any period of time, I'm in chronic pain. Hopefully I smile more than frown. So most folks hopefully aren't aware that I'm in tremendous pain.
And now let's take one final short journey. Once again, I invite you to experience Election Day from another perspective. Imagine that just as before, you're headed into your polling place to vote. Only this time.
Oh, whoa, wait a minute. Let me give you a hand there. Let me help you. Oh, there we go.
Hey.
No,
I can handle this.
Please, it's no problem. Glad to help.
Sir, it is no problem. Please.
Well, I bet it's tough navigating around in this thing, isn't it?
No, sir. Actually, it's not.
Yeah, I'll bet it is. All right. Excuse me, sir.
We're coming through here.
Perfect. Please step aside. Got a handicapped man in a wheelchair here. Please step aside, okay? Oh my, I didn't know we had construction. Oh, I'm sorry, wait a minute. Whoa, wait a minute here. There, I think we can squeeze right through there.
Okay, be careful.
All right, there we go, no problem.
Easy.
Excuse me.
I'm sorry.
Step aside. All right. I think this is yours right here.
Oh, no, watch out.
Oh, okay. Bobby, this guy needs special attention. I want you to take real good care of him, okay? All right? You hang in there, pal.
Oh, how mortifying.
Can you get a sense of how this must feel to someone who uses a wheelchair? If that were me, I believe I would feel embarrassed, insulted, and somewhat demeaned. I would not feel like I was being treated with dignity and respect, but rather like a helpless child. And no one wants to be made to feel like that. Don Dawkins gave us some great distinctions about why this approach doesn't work.
I take pride in the fact that I run my own life and I take care of myself. For instance, I do not like people to push my wheelchair. I push my wheelchair. If I want somebody to push it, I'll request that assistance.
You play a vitally important role in everyone's ability to make their voices heard. As a professional poll worker, you can literally help America vote by lending your sensitivity, knowledge, and assistance to every single person who enters your polling place on election day. So on behalf of everyone who exercises their precious right to vote, thank you for the incredibly important part that you play in that process. I'll leave you now with the words of disability advocate Dave Caulfield.
You know, at one independent living center, I saw this sign on the wall. I really liked it. It was a takeoff from Star Trek. To boldly go where everybody else goes with ease. And I think that's really what people with disabilities are wanting, you know, to be able to be part of the society, the mainstream of society.